Welcome to another edition of Legislative Journal. I'm Chris Caracino, alongside Representative Greg Vitali. Representative, thank you so much for joining us today.
Well, Chris, thank you for hosting.
Another state budget in the books, passed now, but another one that's not so friendly to the environment.
Right, yeah, no, budget 27 for me. And this was particularly disappointing because I think, by and large, it was proposed in very similar form that it ended up in by our own Democratic governor. So, I mean, the good news was it was passed on time, even a little bit early. And further good news was there were no new taxes, per se. But from my perspective, that's where the good news ended. I think one of the problems was the governor proposed what I would consider a very unambitious budget. In fact, the budget he proposed, and we'll talk about this a little more, transferred monies from important environmental funds. So it really started out on a bad foot, and the budget he proposed did not provide any additional staffing for the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection, which has been chronically funded for years. So he started out on the wrong foot. Our hope was in the process between February, when he proposed this, and the end of June, when we would approve it, that we could, that we would improve it a bit. He got a lot of blowback from environmental groups and others on the environmental funds transfers and some other issues. But in the end, no, it ended up from an environmental perspective to be not a good budget. And when we debated the budget in the final days of June, I pretty vehemently opposed it.
And you spoke your mind on the House floor. We'd like to take you to the House floor to show you Representative Vitali voicing his frustration.
I rise in opposition to House Bill 790. This bill is a terrible bill from an environmental perspective. With regard to DEP staffing, the last time DEP was at full staffing was 15 years ago. They are now down almost 1,000 positions. Regrettably, when the governor proposed his budget, he maintained existing staff levels, which are about 30% below what they should be. I've had many conversations with high-level DEP current staffers and former secretaries. This agency simply can't fulfill its mission. It's not meeting its obligations with regard to protecting our streams and waterways. It is not meeting its obligations with regard to the oil and gas program. It is not meeting its obligations with regard to the Chesapeake Bay. On and on and on. It is unconscionable that we do not properly fund this agency, and this budget does not do that. As a very small point, the Delaware River Basin Commission, under Corbett, it was cut, its funding was cut in half to punish it for not allowing gas drilling development in the Delaware River Basin Commission. This budget is even half of the Corbett punishment. Why would we propose and vote for such a thing? Mr. Speaker, finally, with regard to environmental transfers, Mr. Speaker, we, for the first time, have made significant transfers from valuable environmental programs. Governor Wolf proposed these in February, and I'm still scratching my head why. He proposed $16 million from the Environmental Stewardship Program. That's a very valuable program that funds things like open farmland protection, open space protection, watershed protection, abandoned mine reclamation, and so forth, and we're taking $16 million from that while we're putting over $200 million in the Rainy Day Fund. Why are we raiding environmental programs for general government operations when we're putting money in the Rainy Day Fund? We are taking $10 million from the Recycling Fund. This funds our communities, grants for trucks and equipment and composting and other valuable things our communities depend upon. Someone made the comment because both the Environmental Stewardship Fund and the Recycling Fund come from waste fees. This is the most the Department of Environmental Protection has ever been funded by the waste industry. Our Department of Environmental Protection is now being funded by the waste industry. But most importantly, it's the Oil and Gas Fund. The Oil and Gas Lease Fund was established for conservation purposes, but we've been using it as a piggy bank for general government operations. Mr. Speaker, we are taking $70 million out of the Oil and Gas Lease Fund to run government. Mr. Speaker, this is in direct violation of Article 1, Section 27 of the Pennsylvania Constitution. In 2017, in June, in the case of Environmental Defense Foundation versus Wolf, the PA Supreme Court was very clear. We cannot use royalties for general government operations. The court was clear on this point, and that's precisely what we're doing. If you look at the budget, you will see that we are taking this money and using it for general government operations. This is unconscionable. We have a duty to uphold our Constitution. We've taken a sworn oath, but this year after year, we have violated the Constitution by transferring monies out of the Oil and Gas Lease Fund in direct violation of a Pennsylvania Supreme Court decision. Therefore, I move to have this bill, House Bill 790, declared unconstitutional for violation of Article 1, Section 27 of the Pennsylvania Constitution. I so move.
Now, why don't you explain the motion of constitutionality a little bit?
Right. Any law that the legislature passes has to conform with the Pennsylvania Constitution. And as you heard in that clip, the provision that transferred money out of the Oil and Gas Lease Fund for general government operations did not. So I made that motion. And then went on to argue it. I laid out the arguments because I think that the court cases are pretty clear. What happened there was kind of interesting because the powers that be in my caucus were not pleased with that. Our members did not want to vote on that. In fact, in the course of arguing the motion, my leadership came up to me and said, don't do this. And others came up and said, you know, if you do it, we're voting against you. So in the end, I just made a political decision that the goodwill I would lose and the political capital I lose wasn't really worth it because I was going to lose the motion anyway. So we withdrew the motion. But I mean, another dynamic at work here is the knowledge that budget negotiators, by that I mean, you know, the Senate and House leaders, they know they can stick unconstitutional things in the budget, unconstitutional spending. And if, in fact, it's challenged, by the time the challenge gets up to and is decided by the courts, the money's been long spent, so it's almost a moot point. So viewing that, understanding that, they frequently put things in the budget and related documents, such as the fiscal code, that simply aren't constitutional. And I think that this was just another example of that. They kind of view the Constitution as suggestions, you know, as opposed to an oath they've taken.
And it's important to point out that the budget isn't just one bill, it's a series of bills.
Right, sure. I mean, so what people commonly think of as the budget is what we just were debating, which was the general appropriations bill or the spending bill. But there are other so-called code bills that go along with that. Most prominent is the fiscal code, which is sort of, it gives direction to how this money should be spent, like it just specific, you know, directions. But there are other bills. There's the education code and the tax code and you know, depending on the year, the administrative code and so forth. So there could be, then there's the, you know, capital budget, the non-preferred. So it's really just a whole package of bills that kind of move through. More or less together. So the real problem is the problematic bill tends to be the fiscal code. Mm-hmm. And in this budget, which I could talk about for a second, something particularly egregious was inserted in the fiscal code, which was a provision inserted by Senator Cormann, who's the Senate Majority Leader up up in the center of the state, kind of the Lock Haven area, give or take a township or two, who inserted a provision that prevented the state itself and various municipalities, such as the city of Philadelphia and every other municipality in the state, from passing for 1 year any provision that would regulate single-use plastics. And just coincidentally enough, 2 weeks before this, the city of Philadelphia, Councilman Mark Squilla, had introduced a bill that would regulate single-use plastic bags. And the reason Senator Cormann did that, in my view, is pretty clear. He has a company in his district, Novolex, which is the biggest manufacturer of plastic, single-use plastic bags in the country. And there's about 150 jobs in his district. And he introduced that just for his own, you know, political, you know, district self-interest of protecting that company. Now, that, interestingly enough, had been introduced, the same provision had been introduced in two different previous sessions, one by Representative Hanna, also from that same area. The plant is in Milesburg, incidentally. And we had defeated it once in one term, and then it came back again, and it barely passed, and Governor Wolf vetoed it. And Governor Wolf was very clear that violated Article, the Environmental Rights Amendment to the Constitution, Article 1, Section 27. He vetoed it, saying that specifically, which he was correct there. But this time, you know, they threw it in the fiscal code, knowing it had a lot of other things that, you know, were wanted by the governor and others. And the governor did not veto it. So this was just, this is, you know, the hard reality of how politics work in Harrisburg. And, you know, I mean, he said, you know, Cormann said that, well, we're just going to study it for a year, which is nonsense. This will take us to next year. Right. This year will take us to next year's fiscal code. I saw this again and again, like with the conventional drilling regulations. Every year in the budget document, they had a reason for blocking it. 1 year it was a study, next year it was this. Mm-hmm. It's just, in my view, the abuse of power, the arrogance of power, the abuse of power. And but this is the world we operate in, and we do the best we can. We raise the issues, and we try to expose it. But and the other thing in the fiscal code I'll touch on, in addition to the plastics issue, is something called REGI, which people who care about climate change were hoping would be in this budget. REGI stands for the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative. Mm-hmm. It's a 10-state program which is designed to reduce greenhouse gas emissions from the power sector. In other words, the coal-fired power plants, the gas-fired power plants that produce the electricity that's lighting these lights, for example. And the way it does that is by establishing a cap-and-trade program. It caps the level of CO2 emissions from these plants, and then gives allotments to each of the emitters, and you can't go above that allotment. And each year, it lowers the cap a bit, getting us down to the greenhouse gas goals we want. And emitters who can't reach that, their allotment, have to buy allotments off of emitters who are doing much better. So it's really a market-based program. There's a lot of discussion and talk and language that Pennsylvania joining REGI, or at least some preliminary steps that Pennsylvania joining REGI would be in this year's budget. But in the end, it wasn't. Mm-hmm. And that's a disappointment, but not entirely unexpected. So by and large, very little positive from an environmental perspective in this budget. You know, I was hoping, given all these new freshmen that came in from the Southeast with the 2018 elections and all the pressure they were exerting, that in some way our leadership, House Democratic leadership, or the governor would somehow respond to this new political dynamic of the caucus, but it didn't seem like it at all.
Now, budget may be done, and it's the summer, doesn't mean the work is done. Why don't you tell us what's happened now during the summer?
Yeah, summer's a good time to regroup. So we have 2.5 months. We're not back until mid-September. Mm-hmm. So it's a good time to catch up on things. We just spent a lot of time getting a newsletter out, just wrote a guest column, analyzing this budget, circulating that. But I think it's a time for gathering background information, because you just can't go up there and vote all the time. You kind of get the knowledge that puts you in a position to take the correct vote. So one thing we do is go on site tours. So we have three of them planned, for example. Late August, Southwest, which is a gas drilling company, is going to take us up to the Scranton area, outside of Scranton, and show us what they're doing as far as reducing methane emissions. Mm-hmm. And this will inform us as to when we lobby the Wolf administration on their regulations or lack thereof. So that's a good tour coming up. We also are going to, our committee, environmental, I'm doing that on my own, our committee, the environmental committee, coming up very soon, is going to just do a tour of the offices in Harrisburg of the Susquehanna River Basin Commission. That was sort of the subject of controversy, because they're creating or incurring the ire of certain members who don't like their decisions with regard to water withdrawals and how the lack of permission impacts some industries in their area. So we'll just, I'm very glad they're doing this, because I think it's going to cause the conservatives who take that tour to come around to my way of thinking, because Susquehanna River Basin Commission has nothing to hide and does a great job. So I'm glad that. And then we have another tour, which just got on the book yesterday, from and which involves going to York and touring a recycling facility and a landfill facility. So again, there's no specific bill this tour is attached to that I'm aware of, but I have a feeling there might be. But it's just, you get all this background information. So when you get back into the flurry of the legislative session, when all of a sudden a bill jumps on your calendar 2 days into the future and you got to file an amendment, it's like, okay, I know what this is about. I've been there. I remember this. So it's really a good time to do that. So there's a lot of good stuff that it's just a good time to regroup. Maybe I'll even work on my house and stuff like that. Take a vacation, and we're gonna. One thing I'm gonna do in the summer is I like to go to this conference. It's the National Conference of Environmental Legislators. It's a 2-day conference in. 3-day conference in Nashville. The location varies every year, and it's just good background information on a wide variety of national environmental issues. And I find that when you hear the perspective of environmental legislators throughout the country, it kind of gives you ideas. Even if you get a couple of good ideas, it's worth the time you spent. So I think it's about a 12-hour drive. So I'm going to get my car and I'm going to kind of build it out into a long, a week-long vacation. Take some time to get there, time to get back. But I always enjoy the networking with other legislators and learning about the, what other people are doing in other states as far as the environment goes. So, things should be a good summer. I'm looking forward to it.
So you regroup, you do your research in the summer. You just mentioned you come back September in the fall. What are your priorities come the fall?
Good question. A lot of it simply, frankly, will be playing defense, because even though we do have a Democratic governor, the House and the Senate are both solidly in Republican conservative control. Mm-hmm. So a lot of it will just be getting ready to for the bills we think they will try to introduce and playing defense on them. But offensively, Governor Wolf, it's been over 3 years, he introduced a bill, not a bill, but a proposal to regulate methane from existing sources in the oil and gas industry, and God knows why that isn't moving. It's just not moving at all. And, you know, I think trying to just figure out what we can do to light a fire, to get those things in place as soon as we can is one of our, one of the things we'll be doing this summer into the fall. And we discussed Reggie and maybe trying to see what we can do in the fall to get that on the table. The nuclear bill stalled. We talked about that in previous shows. But the issue is still there, because even though TMI is going to be closing and there are in 2020 and 2021 two power plants owned by First Energy, the Beaver Valley plants, the western part of the state, they are scheduled to close, and the greenhouse gas consequences of that are unfortunate. So that might be a fall thing too, although I think with TMI closing, the urgency of that issue seems like it left us for a little bit. So that's another fall thing we may be dealing with. But so it's, I think it's just a matter of being prepared for the various bills that might be coming along and playing a good, tough defense.
Going back to methane, just for the people watching at home, why don't you tell us why regulating methane is so important?
Great question. Thank you. Methane is actually, when you turn on your burner, a gas burner on your stove, that blue flame coming out of it is essentially methane. And methane, and it's no problem when it's being burnt like that, but unburnt methane or leakage, methane leakage, fugitive methane emissions or leakage, that happens in the oil and gas sector at any point from the time they drill a well to processing it through the pipelines, through the compressor facilities, and so forth, right up until, your burner tip or gas heater or whatever. So it's leaking into the atmosphere. And the methane actually is the second, it's a greenhouse gas. And it's the second most prevalent greenhouse gas after CO2. And in fact, it has a different greenhouse gas characteristics, because it's a much more potent greenhouse gas. It has many times much more the heat trapping abilities of CO2. But happily, it has a shorter shelf life. So it's a very potent greenhouse gas. And the oil and gas industry is a significant greenhouse gas emitter. That's why reducing methane emissions from the 11,000 wells that are already producing greenhouse gas in Pennsylvania is very important. Governor Wolf did something with regard to new sources, but the lion's share of the leakage is from the 11,000 wells that are producing right now, and we haven't increase their regulations. So that's why methane is so important.
And I know you said you've been getting, not pushback, but it's been hard for you, especially with the Governor Wolf administration, to get things passed regarding the methane. Moving forward here as we get into the fall, what do you think are the chances of, getting some legislation going here? And
yeah, but the key thing is this. It's in Governor Wolf's hands right now, because it's not legislation per se. It's regulations. It's something that goes that would be proposed by his Department of Environmental Protection and would be considered by the Environmental Quality Board and then would go through this maybe two-year regulatory review process and finally be promulgated. I mean, the legislature could theoretically block it, but that block would involve a veto by Wolf, which he's not going to block his own.
Right.
But we have not proposed anything regarding methane from existing sources to the Environmental Quality Board yet. And once we do that, that's usually give or take a two-year process. So we are really far away from regulating the industry, which is unfortunate, because, and it's all frankly due to pressure from the economic interests of people like the Marcellus Coalition mm-hmm. and others who don't want to be subject to tougher regulations. So it's a matter of pressuring the governor to mm-hmm. Get moving on this. I mean, it kind of a lot of these issues are interrelated because we talked at the outset of the gross underfunding of the Department of Environmental Protection, and one reason they're so slow on these regs is they're not devoting the people to do it. I mean, their people in candid moments will just say, you just don't have the people to do right. this. So it's probably some combination of not having the political will to do it and not devoting the people, which are probably go hand in hand. Probably if you had the political will, you would devote the people. So it's just, I think it's more a matter of political will more than anything else. One skeptical former DEP secretary said, this will probably just be ridden out until the Wolf term is over so he doesn't have to deal with it. I hope that's not the case. Mm-hmm. I'm sure that their people will vehemently, object to that. Mm-hmm. You got to show it. You got to get it done.
From Harrisburg back into your district, there's some local things going on here. You want to talk about the opening of your satellite office?
Yeah, very exciting. We are, by the time people view this, we will, every Thursday mm-hmm. from 10 to 2, we'll have office hours in the basement of the Ardmore Library, which is entirely handicapped accessible. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a sort of a circuit, good, great parking and handicap ramps. It's have to take a circuitous path once you get there, but you can get there without taking any steps, I assure you. And we did this for one reason, but I think it has two benefits. And the main reason we did it was, we have been getting these, concerns by seniors and others who said, listen, those steps are a problem. Mm-hmm. And I agree with them. One reason was we wanted to have something that was totally handicapped accessible, no steps, so people who truly won't be denied. And the second was an added benefit was a different geographic location. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you look at a map of my district office is sort of like at the southeastern edge of it. Mm-hmm. And this Ardmore location puts us right squarely in the middle of a population, puts us right in the middle of a population center, and probably, I would say, a more needy, population center. I would say that the people in Radnor and the, mainline Midi estates do not need our services the way, people, more solidly in the middle class mm-hmm. need our services. And so I think you're putting an office in a population center that actually is more likely to use it. So it's a good thing.
Yeah.
It's a good thing. It's about time, really. I should have done it years ago.
Ardmore Bridge, want to give us any updates going on there?
Real quick, by the time people view this, it will probably be closed. The short answer is it'll probably be down for a year. We're not going to have the problems of the College Avenue Bridge. I mean, the College Avenue Bridge, because we got all of the utility easements done beforehand. We learned a lesson there. When it comes back, it'll be a wider bridge. It'll be an improved bridge. Mm-hmm. It'll be a wider bridge. And so the detour should be clearly marked. Expect it to be down for about a year, and no long delays. No delays long on that. We promise you to the extent we can.
Okay. Promise. If anybody has any questions about that or anything else, how do they get in touch with you?
Call my district office 610-789-3900 or stop in. There's no special number for the satellite office. It's just the district office number.
All right, Representative, thank you so much for joining us, and thank you at home for watching. We'll see you next time for another edition of Legislative Journal.